about today between these two teams?
Well, we have heard the first whistle. There was a little bit of a stall as the teams just kind of looked at the track a moment. And we have a 0-1-1 baby nuclear for the Hellions of Troy and 105 Lex for the Low Country High Rollers, and it is Lex's lead jammer.
Yep, Lex McCusker is one of the powerhouse skaters for Low Country. Been doing a lot of work this year, really coming into her own. She's always been amazing, but really starting to stand out this year for Low Country.
Baby Nuclear putting a little pressure on Lex to hit it and quit it, and she sure does get a few points. She looks back to see how much time she has and calls it, looking like a two jam. It is a little tricky to see the fingers through there, but I love this official out there who puts the tape on his fingers.
It does make it a little easier to see. Yeah, that's a 2-2 jam. Lex calling it off just a little bit of late, allowing those 2 points in. This time we're going to see Green-Eyed Sniper taking the jammer line for the Low Country High Rollers. Low Country in black, mostly. And it's going to be number 109. That's going to be Bloody Knuckles Betty in the ladies in pink and black.
We are already seeing one of the Low Country High Rollers, 1964, I believe that is Ringo, going to the penalty box.
Ringo is going to spend a little time there. Green-Eyed Sniper finds her way around the outside and picks up the lead jam for Low Country.
Betty is through now, though, and going to put some pressure, but not before Sniper is getting through, getting all her points, calling it off. And the Low Country High Rollers take the lead at 6-2. 28 minutes left in the first period.
Yes, I think Sniper wanted to fix that little mistake Lex did there and allowed those 2 points when she could have called him off. So calling him off nice and early. I've always been kind of suspect about waiting till the very last second because, man, some of those skaters have a beautiful burst of speed.
I think she had a little more room to do that, though. It was definitely a tougher, tighter jam, that first jam. We're looking at a 0-1-1 baby and 2-1 Powderpuff Girls jamming for the Low Country High Rollers. Hellions holding the back, but with only one Low Country High Roller blocker back there, doing a number on baby in the back, and it is curls for lead jammer.
Well, that one blocker doing the work back there, that is Detroit Funk, a powerhouse blocker for the Low Country High Rollers. You will see her all day long.
Without a doubt, it was kind of like a 3-1 scenario there, and we have the girls calling it off for 3.
Well, I think also yesterday, the Low Country High Rollers, they got into a matchup with Rideau Valley, and they did not take away the win, so they're really wanting to come and show their presence here today. I talked with a number of them. They're good friends of mine, but they really wanted to come in and make a big showing. They felt like they didn't do their best yesterday, and so you're going to see some big defensive hits. I expect a lot out of Detroit and Lex McCusker today.
Yeah, we have a 6-0-3 Epic Kate Tastrophe jamming for the Hellions. She goes outside, takes the inside, finds herself lead very quickly. Nice moving around on her part. The Hellions are keeping a 105 Lex for the Low Country, stuck in the packs. A nice four wall up front, working tightly together. 3/4 of a lap lead. Epic has a little bit of opportunity to do things right and get some points, but that little trip is not helping her, and I don't think she's aware she is. She calls that off.
Yeah, Ringo Stardust comes in from the penalty box, and literally within 2 seconds of being on the track comes across, I believe that was a low cut or a low block that she got called for, and didn't even make it out of the penalty zone.
You were mentioning Redo earlier. I have played against them. They are a tough team, and I think we're going to see some of those ladies later playing at Team Canada. 0-1-1, Baby Nuclear taking the jam line against number 50, Sniper.
Sniper with a little bump there starting off.
Hellions with a slight bit of pack advantage, and it makes a difference for Baby Nuclear, lead jammer for the Hellions of Troy.
She's got Green-Eyed Sniper right on her six, though, and Sniper's going to catch that inside line in just a second.
Without a doubt, a quick 0-0 jam. Low Country still ahead, 9-2. The Hellions, 5. 25 minutes remaining here in this first period.
Well, it's a nice start by both teams getting out there. Low Country with the first few jams, lead jams, and then coming back now. The Hellions of Troy kind of knocking that dust off. They've got a couple of lead jams in, but they've got to watch out for that speed of Sniper. She is definitely dangerous.
Bloody Knuckle Betty's taking the jam line for the Hellions. Powerpuff Curls jamming for Low Country.
Yes, and there's her Smash sister out there, Aphrodite Superstar.
I heard that they are always on the track together.
Oh, you never want to get them apart. And Powerpuff Girls is going to pick up that lead jam for the Low Country High
and
Rollers.
A power jam. I didn't catch the penalty on Betty, but Betty's going to sit in the box for up to a minute here. Hellions having a nice wall holding the curls, but not too long, and she is through for five.
Well, this big story this weekend has been the power jams. A lot of teams living and dying by the power jams this weekend. You don't want to give them up, but some of these teams have just been devastating. You'll have a fairly close game, and then boom, that one power jam, and it's the 30-point deficit. You get two of them in a row, and the game is pretty much out of hand.
You are so right, Professor Liu, and oh, just about getting ready with lap three, and 109. Betty is getting called on a low block. It looked like the lower part of her leg kind of went across Curl's knee as she was working on her third scoring pass.
Well, right now we're getting a little bit of penalty trouble from the Hellions of Troy. They've got a couple of girls in there, but what's more importantly, their jammer is now standing up in the box, and so that next jam is going to start off with the power jam for Low Country.
I didn't quite catch the last points, but we are now up to 24-5. So I think that was a 15-point jam for Sniper. She's going to now send her teammate 105 Lexa to the jam line. And the Hellions jammer, I believe it's Betty, is standing in the box. We'll see her on the track momentarily.
As you said, 23 minutes, 14 seconds left to go in this first half. 24-5, the present score. Ladies in pink trailing the ladies in black.
Lex pushing against that wall. It doesn't take her long to spread it out. She's pushing an out-of-play blocker in the front, and she is lead. And here comes a Betty, about a half track behind her, going to try to put the pressure on. And picking up a bunch of, I think what it is the whistles behind us pick up a microphone, so I hear them before us.
Well, that was a nice job by the Hellions of Troy switching their defense up. They had taken that line in the back, and as soon as they saw Lex coming around the corner, quickly popped it to the front.
Pays off, and here's another one of these tied jams, 2-2. No advantage for either team. Good job, Hellions. Baby Nuclear taking the jam line for the Hellions, and number 50, Green Egg Sniper for the High Rollers.
And you'll definitely see Sniper out there a good bit. We did see Baby Nuclear out there a good bit yesterday as well for the Hellions of Troy. Once again, the Hellions of Troy in pink and black today, and the Low Country High Rollers in mostly black.
They're like reversed out there, and that is a Sniper for lead jammer for the High Rollers, the Baby Nuclear all of about 30 feet behind her and not slowing up. The pack is super fast. We've seen incredible super fast packs here at ECDX.
Oh, and that last Glasgow game, that one race at the end, it was amazing. That was one of the fastest jams I've ever seen, and it was for the win, too.
When you are going for the win, you don't care about how hard your win did.
And, you know, ECDX has always been one of those premier events for the year in roller derby, and I got to say, this year we have had more close, exciting games.
I was thinking the same thing myself, Lou. It's just so many times at ECDX people have complained about how disparate the scores are, but the teams that have been matched up are very closely ranked. Now, the Hellions here are unranked, but Low Country is in 79, so they're outside of the Division 2. This is a great matchup for these teams.
Yeah, they came in, as you said, they're unranked. Let's see, they did play. River City was ranked 78 yesterday and put a pretty good game, so going against a number 79 team, absolutely perfect.
Betty has taken the lead for the Hellions. The Hellions need this with a 29-7 deficit, but Curls is putting the pressure on. Fast pack and a light pack, two-on-two blockers. And the Hellions blocker gives her skater a chance to pick up not only that one easy point that the blocker helped with, but two in the box for her. So that's a 3-0 jam for the Hellions.
That was Katie Bang doing a nice little bit of work there on Spaghetto. Fabulous, a big shot. And you're absolutely right, that freed her up to get those points. A very well-timed block. We are seeing a very light pack again. A lot of players in the penalty box.
We have 105 Lex McCusker jamming for the Low Country. 1603 Epic Catastrophe jamming for the Hellions of Troy.
Lex finds her way through, and she's going to pick up that lead jam once again for Low Country High Rollers, trying to add on to that 19-point lead.
It doesn't look like two blockers from either team really actually stop any jammer, and we have our Kate going to the box for a forearm. Power jam for Low Country, and Lex comes around and just realizes that she didn't know she was on a power jam. He totally sucked. Just like, oh. Either that or she was very excited. I'm not sure if that was a happy scream or an oh, crap scream.
We'll go with a happy scream.
Happy scream. She was excited to get that. And she's going to turn that jammer line over to Sniper now.
She was like, I know the next jammer, and she can go fast.
Well, we have a 3-2 pack advantage here for Low Country.
The penalty is taking an early toll in this game. That's going to be one thing both teams are going to need to work out if they can.
And it didn't take but, 5 seconds here for Sniper to find herself lead jammer.
You know, there's a lot of different styles of jammers, and Sniper is one of those girls that I absolutely love watching because somehow she knows where the holes are going to be, usually a step or two beforehand, and you're not going to see the space, but she does.
There was some fantastic blocking out there by the Low Country. I was watching in corner three as they stopped the Stole Crush. The Hellions were trying to cycle back and bring Sniper back, but they were just chest bumping the Hellions and keeping them from going back to draw their jammer back. So I have lost track of the scoring passes. I believe this is her second. And someone is getting sent to the box for a back block, and it appears to be Sniper.
Oh, a big turn of events there, but a big opportunity right now for the Hellions of Troy. They can really take some advantage of this. They need to put some points on the board and get a little momentum going.
I think they're going to have a chance. Kate was already standing before Sniper came in, and so Kate's going to have almost a full minute on this pack, but this, of course, is her initial pass. So no points this time through. And 46 seconds of jam time here to put some points on the board and possibly turn this over then to still being a power jam on the next play.
Oh, and a nice little pop there by Dutasmania. A little Malachi crunch there going on.
And bridging to keep allowing and slowing this down, the Low Country doing a pretty good job of slowing the jammer. They're not going to completely stop here this game, it looks like, but enough to really reduce the scoring passes. Low Country having much more points during these situations, but Hellions really need this now.
Yeah, they were killing it nicely. They took about 40 seconds off that clock killing that jam. She did make that 5 points on the pass. Is probably going to get another 5 coming in right here.
And a direction of gameplay penalty is going to send a very slow skating captain through 1-3 Detroit Funk. I'm sorry, is she not going to the penalty box? Somebody's going to the penalty box for direction.
Well, Sniper is going to be standing in the penalty box when we get this next one standard. I do believe that this may be an official Wicked Skatewear timeout.
It looks like it's a team timeout for the Low Country High Rollers. Looking at our jam timer, we did not get a roster up here, so I don't know who all the officials are down there. Well, the interesting game so far here, Lou. The Hellions definitely brought it up to 20 now, 20-39.
Oh, that's nice, and they utilized that power jam. Low Country did do a nice job slowing things down, but still, the Hellions of Troy have to get those points in, and they're gonna need to consistently get those points in. But big thing right now, penalty time. So much penalty time.
Yeah. And the Hellions, they aren't unfamiliar with tournaments. This might be their first East Coast Derby Extravaganza. Now we're on an official timeout for Wicked Skatewear. All official timeouts here at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza. Brought to you by Wicked Skatewear. As I was saying, though, the Hellions have played at the Empire Skate Showdown a couple years in a row now, so they aren't unfamiliar with a tournament-style setting, but they really only have their roster here today. So the same 14 skaters who played yesterday are playing today. They're probably a little tired.
And you also get in the factor of how many teams have had their skaters also going on to challenge bouts, doing other things. As we know, East Coast Derby Extravaganza is mainly roller derby, but there's so much more going on. There's the pool party going on at all times, the wonderful food, dancing out there. There's all the merchants that you can check out. There's the great food outside.
There's so, great beer inside.
Yeah, and the after party, from what I understand last night, was so packed that it was overflowing
going out of the hotel.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I put too much into ECDX here at the rinks to find those after parties. It may just be that I'm getting too old for that. I'm not sure, Captain Lou.
Well, you know, we go through four or five bouts, and yeah, granted, we're not skating, but sometimes announcing can be a little mentally taxing, especially when we're working with teams that, you know, might be brand new for us. So.
I did skate yesterday, actually, so that was fun.
So you got...
Yeah,
you got,
I did get a little skating, a little announcing.
You got the whole night. You got the full
A little beer.
ECDX
I didn't get
experience.
To the pool. I was too busy to get to the pool. Last year I got to the pool. Maybe this afternoon. It is amazing out there.
I am planning on actually getting out there and getting my pale skin a little. As long as it doesn't rain, of course, I would like to be swimming in the pool.
But hats off to the Philly Roller Girls for the production they put on here 7 years now, and I swear it gets better every year.
You know, I was just about to say, I missed the very first one because of the snowstorm, and I was really bummed and have been to every one since, and every year it gets better and better, and it runs smoother and smoother. And the quality of teams are getting better and better, and it's really amazing. This, for us, it's our opportunity to work with some of these great announcers that we've heard or we've only gotten to see online. For us, it's this gelling opportunity for all our fans and our friends that we've always wanted to work to. We actually get a chance to work with our co-announcers, and I mean, I'm always tickled doing it.
Yeah, Professor Lou, people were just going to say, you know, us and our derby knowledge here on the microphone together was going to be amazing. There's not been anything too tricky out there on the track.
No, it's not too much. We're playing a pretty straightforward game so far. They're not... we haven't seen the pivot line possession, which, you know, I think we might actually see a little later this game.
I saw a couple of those with Ithaca and Long Island yesterday.
I've been impressed that it's coming back, and people are, and teams are actually realizing that there takes a lot of different derby strategies and theories. It's not just a simple little game that you only just try to skate fast and turn left and... we're starting to see the transition from other sports. The pick and roll from basketball is a huge thing that you're starting to see now in derby, getting your jammer through the pack. And they're starting to really concentrate on actual plays.
Yeah.
That these are, you know, hey, when you're having this is your set play. Your two blockers will open up your zone there.
Yeah, well, being over in the challenge rink, I also got the experience of hearing jammers talk about whether they wanted their blockers on the jammer line or the front of the jammer line, and understanding the subtleties of jammer preference and pack abilities, and I think we're seeing this on the track. It takes a little longer to convert when you're only observing it. Well, it does for me anyway. I know somebody like you, Professor Lou, you probably see all those subtleties right off the bat. But we have a little bit of a spread out pack here right now. The Hellions doing that jump back off the jammer line. We've seen a lot of that spring roll earlier.
Yeah, they're pushing for that split track start and also getting the jammer to cycle back as far as she can.
That was a sweet little play. Nice job on the Hellions. They have lead, and Sniper is in.
Like I said, we're starting to see those set plays a little more, and, you know, I love this transition coming in, because you are seeing some amazing derby.
Hopping through on one foot, about five little hops there. We have Betty getting her first full scoring pass. Sniper's still stuck in the back, but hopping through. Betty's coming around and going to have a chance at picking up a couple points. She only needs to get one of those two black blockers in order to get her 2 points for the penalty box, and she's going to be happy with one. She's not waiting.
Yeah, Sniper is on the way up, and she's already realized Sniper's got a nice little bunch of speed in her legs. Now we're down to just a 11-point separation on the two teams. Lowcountry High Rollers in black with 39 points, and the Hellions of Troy in pink and black with 28.
I think this is Tiantina's first time to the jammer line for Lowcountry, but against someone we've seen quite regularly, Baby Nuclear, 0-1-1.
Yeah, I like the rotation of Lowcountry. They've got quite a number of girls who can jam. They do have a pretty tight rotation they stick with, but they do like to throw the occasional one out there.
Tiantina trying to do a little knockout, but no drawback, and so Baby Nuclear just comes right back in, keeps her hips behind her. Baby Nuclear grabbing lead jammer, getting the point she can and calling it off, and that is going to be 0 points for Lowcountry. We're trying to get an idea that the referees are communicating 0 points for the Hellions.
Well, she did kind of take a seater as she was coming up to the pack. I guess she didn't get her hips past anybody in time.
That new rule now, used to be you didn't actually have to be on your skates to score. You could slide past someone as long as you were in bounds. Saw the guys do a lot of knee slides right through a whole pack. So we've seen that change in the rules, and I've seen that affect the score here a couple times at ECDX. Epic Catastrophe jamming for the Hellions finds an outside line from... for a moment, I thought she was going to make it, although I think I did just confuse her with her pivot for a moment. Both jammers out of the front of the pack at a similar time, but a cut track for Kate. She goes to the box. That is a lead jammer for Sniper on a power jam.
So right now, Low Country's got that opportunity. They've set their line. I like that, too. They open up, trying to open a little room for their jammer.
Hellions are right there moving forward with them, though. On the rush, they slow it down a little bit, but first grand slam for Sniper of this power jam.
Sniper doing a nice little job switching fields there, cutting through the Hellions of Troy and putting another 5 points on the board for the Low Country High Rollers.
It is a slow pack on turn two for us. And another little rush from Low Country's blockers trying to get through. That is the 15 points now for Sniper this jam.
And she's got a lot of time left on the jam, too. Another 55 seconds left on the jam clock.
As Kate stands in the penalty box, she's got about 10 more seconds of jamming alone. She's probably going to start this first scoring pass all on her own, and Kate hasn't even done an initial pass, but I guess she's done with it. 59 for Low Country, 28 Hellions of Troy. We are passing the 14-second mark here in the first half.
That was a big 20-point jam for the Low Country High Rollers. Sniper just rolling them off quickly.
Powerpuff Girls taking the jam line for Low Country. A Baby Nuclear returning for the Hellions. We've seen Baby Nuclear quite a few times out there.
She did a great job yesterday. An awesome jammer. Very consistent. Curl's doing a nice little jump over Nuclear. She's left with that three wall of ladies in pink out front. Now down to just a two wall.
Katie Bang, of course, doing a fantastic job, but pays a penalty for it and finds herself in the penalty box.
And Baby Nuclear is going to pick up the lead jam, and she is going to go ahead and call it off. Powerpuff Girls did get it out first.
0-0 jam.
And really, except for a power jam or two, this has been a very well matched out game.
It has, Lou. It really has. A very similar strategies too. No one's pulling anything surprising on the others. The Hellions tried that jump back. I think we see a little more engaging from Low Country High Rollers in the power jam scenario. So they're getting their points a little faster. But otherwise, those are the two real deciding strategies I've seen. And we're going to see Lex get lead jammer for Low Country while Betty is stuck in the pack. Betty getting drawn back. Multiplayer block on our jammer.
Wow.
That bloody knuckles, Betty. That is just an unusual call for a jammer. I can totally see how it can happen. Not letting go of an assist or whatever. It was on the far side of the track. You folks at home, man, have seen a better view of it on your cameras.
Well, with the way the rules are read now, especially with the newer rules on the multiplayer blocks, I think it's going to be one of those that we're going to see a little more and a little more. It almost makes me curious, like, okay, is a whip a multiplayer block?
Only if you're testing those arms. And I haven't actually, we're going to have to disagree on the multiplayer block because I don't think the rules have changed. All they did was add the 2010 clarification to the rule book. We have continually seen that penalty further and further refined by the WFTDA. And now we are having the Low Country jammer go to the box for a forearm.
That's nice of her to point it out as she's coming around.
Yeah, she was on her bench now. I'm going to call them a forearm.
And again, we've had a great job by all the referees this weekend, the NSOs. It has been such a well-run program.
I'm watching this blocking from Epic Catastrophe trying to keep Tiantina from going backwards. Tiantina, of course, getting a penalty for pushing Epic Catastrophe out of the way. But it was pretty nice. The Low Country was trying to draw Hellions back. He did not really succeed as much as they wanted. And it is a power jam for the Hellions with Betty getting through on a scoring pass now. Cycled back by Captain Detroit Funk. I think you're demonstrating right now what you were talking, that fearful blocker out there. Yep.
She's always one of the most consistent blockers that I've seen, and she will almost emulate a jammer. If your jammer likes getting low to the corners, she will get equally as low to block her. It's just fun to watch her when she is on a mission.
That power jam did not really work out so well for the Hellions of Troy. They're still in the low 30s, 33 to Low Country 74. It's Baby Nuclear takes the jam line. Even packs. Three Hellions, three Low Country High Rollers.
Well, the defense right now for the Low Country High Rollers doing a great job killing any of those power plays.
Yeah, I think we can definitely give Detroit Funk some credit for getting Baby Nuclear to, I'm sorry, it was not Baby Nuclear. I think it was Betty, getting her to call that jam off a little earlier than she might have otherwise in the last jam.
Well, it might have been, might as well have been Baby Nuclear, because she's probably going to get her to do it as well.
We are on a Wicked Skatewear official timeout here on Rink 3 at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza. We have our jammer referees coming over and checking the scoreboard.
We do have a lot of great games coming again on track number 3 here. Right after this Low Country Hellions of Troy, we're going to have Columbia versus Dutchland from 3 to 5 o'clock.
Oh, that's going to be a good one.
That should be. And Columbia's got something to prove. They're trying to get their way into the Division I rankings, and they have to have some big wins here to do it.
Well, that's kind of exciting. ECDX, of course, is really their last big a possibility for doing. We have a cut track on Baby Nuclear of the pair of eyes from the jam ref and the outside pack ref working together, sending her to the box, and we're going to cycle these power jam, these jammers again.
So we are going to see the Low Country High Rollers, Lexmith Cusker, coming back onto the track. 9 minutes, 26 seconds left to go. 74 to 33, the present score.
Lex working on that group of blockers way out of play. Not enough impact by Katie Bang to send her to the box as she draws back and reforms with her teammates. Another rush from the High Rollers in the back, getting the pack moving but opening up some holes. So Lex has a chance to get through and complete this scoring pass. And again, Katie Bang way out of play. And this time going to the box for it.
I was about to say, I don't think she's going to get the free pass on that one. Lex actually finding a quick little seam on the inside, puts a fast five in the air.
Her third pass, second scoring pass. Another little rush, and here we see the Low Country High Rollers just getting enough blockers. It only takes two. If we leave Lex with only two blockers, she seems to be able to manage them pretty well on her own.
Lex is a very powerful skater, and she sent teams to get better throughout the game as well. Just very powerful legs. You'll see her play more and more in the second half.
87 for Low Country, 33 for the Hellions of Troy, 8:24 remaining in the first period, and we are on a timeout for... for the Hellions of Troy. And we see Massacre, their jam coach, out having a discussion with a head referee. This is still a team timeout. It has not turned into an official review just yet.
And back to some of those games that we're going to have later here on track number 3 from 5 to 7. It's going to be Tampa versus Boston, which nice East Coast rivalry there from the Northeast to the Southeast. And then finally, the big one everybody has been talking about today, and I've heard nothing but, we're going to Team USA versus Team Canada.
Now we'll be on the microphone, but down on the floor, so folks at home, we'll be listening to some great announcing up here on the bridge. I'm sure you'll be hearing the screams from the fans down there. It's going to be loud.
Oh, yeah. Well, if it's anything like that Glasgow Long Island game, the screams were actually drowning out some of the announcers as it was going on. So,
just a reminder to you folks, talk amongst yourself there at home with hashtag talk to WFTDA. Talk to WFTDA. It is a jam with both jammers on the track. We haven't seen that in a little bit here, Lou.
Yeah, I almost thought somebody was blocking my view, and I thought we had an empty penalty box, and I was just not going to be in belief. Powerpuff Curls finding her way through for the Low Country High Rollers in black. That's number 2-1, picking up the lead jam.
And Betty really just stuck behind Sketo there. Having a tough time in the back of the pack. She's made it past that back wall, looking again at the front now.
Yep, Raven McCoy taking up a little bit of blocking there in the front with Hurricane Camille.
Betty through now, just completing her initial pass as Curls is scoring, taken out, looks like, by Kate. And Kate giving a little track direction to the rest of her blockers as well.
And I'm loving the fans. This is one of the great things about ECDX, watching the fans. And you don't need a jammer coach at ECDX because the fans will tell you when to call the jam.
I've seen fans call it wrong, though, and I don't know if they mean to do it intentionally or they're just really not aware of the other scoring pass, of the other jammer, and those kinds of things as well. So you've got to be careful. If you don't know who that is, you don't listen to them. And here we have number 50 is Sniper jamming against Baby Nuclear. Little side to side, both jammers trying to find those holes, and the Sniper found a big one. She is through in lead, but Baby Nuclear not too far behind her, about 40 feet, and losing Sniper with some amazing strides and catching up to that pack fast.
She's just so fluid.
And her pop blockers, look at that again. That is Detroit Funk getting her the easy point with a knocked out of bounds alien and getting the 2 points in the box. So a quick three, a quick easy three for the High Rollers, moves them up to 94. The Hellions still suck at this 33 points. They've been there for a little while.
But that's a testament to the Low Country's defense right now. They are on point. They are really sticking it to the Hellions of Troy right now. And I guess that game with Rideau Valley just really put something, a little cry in them. And they really want to prove something here at ECDX today.
The Hellions hoping to see how they get ranked out of this. They will be newly ranked in the next round of WFTDA rankings since they hadn't played quite enough games to get ranked. And we have T and Tina jamming and lead. Oh, I apologize. Getting called off the track on a backlock major. That gives Betty a chance to put some points on the board here for the Hellions, something the Hellions desperately need to stay in this game. And she does a nice job of turning around and getting back into the derby direction movement. She is declared lead. A lot of work for an initial pass. Oh, nope. Katie Bang comes in and gets sent right back off because she came in front of two of her own blockers. So an illegal procedure called on her for returning to the track improperly. First grand slam for Bloody Knuckles Betty.
Yeah, that's a tough little mental mistake there for Katie Bang. Such a simple little thing. And
it can be tricky on this outside corner. When you're coming in, you're looking at your perspective, and you're not really thinking about perpendicular to that inside line of the track. So I'm sure it wasn't intentional. She would have taken the couple extra feet. Holy moly. The skate skills from Detroit Funk there, avoiding knockouts, avoiding being the goat. And she is so going to help make Betty's life miserable to get these points. She is making her work hard for it.
Oh, yeah. The Detroit Funk.
Called out of play, though.
Love watching her. Yeah, you don't try to get the goat on Detroit. It's not going to happen.
Well, I mean, she just demonstrated how she wasn't going to get caught, and then really was the reason there was not another scoring pass for the Hellions. But the Hellions, it looks like a 15-point jam for Betty, brings them up to 48. It's nice to see them at closer to half the points of the High Rollers.
Yeah, and a great feeling for them, finally breaking that 33-point lock that they'd had for a little while.
Powerpuff Girls against Baby Nuclear on the jam line, a combination we've seen a couple times now. Less than 4 minutes remaining in our first period, and we get too many pivots on the track for Low Country.
Nice little double jammer take out there, both of them going down in turn number one, but quick recoveries.
It is just a scrum all the way around the track since the jammer line, but we do see Powerpuff Girls taking the lead for Low Country.
Yeah, she just found a little bit of a line around Layman Smothers and exploited it.
I think she just had the power and the speed to do it, and it is another jam for the Low Country High Rollers as Baby Nuclear goes to the box for a cut track. We've just seen so many penalties here on the Hellions in this first period. It looks like that's only the third, though, for Baby Nuclear. She's not in trouble just yet.
And we do have a couple of players already with a little bit of penalty trouble. Katie Bang's got four majors already for the Hellions of Troy. And very quietly, Ringo Stardust and Detroit Funk for Low Country High Rollers have both picked up four majors.
They've been busy visiting there, but the Low Country High Rollers are making good use of it. They seem to have caught themselves a goat in the back there. So doing some very traditional active offensive work here as I lost track of who our jammer was. Curls gets 10 points that jam and brings them up into triple-digit territory. 109 for Low Country, 48 for the Hellions. The clock has stopped at 2:18. It looks like we are on a Wicked Skatewear official timeout.
Well, with that official timeout, we would like to thank some of our sponsors. We'd like to thank CruiseSkateShop.com for offering quality-tested derby gear and guidance since 2007. That's Cruise Skate Shop. And you can get them online at CruiseSkateShop.com. Also, as always, Wicked Skatewear, the official sponsor of our timeouts here at ECDX. If you need gear, you need Wicked Skatewear.
Well, we have all the captains here in the middle right now having a conversation. It looks like with one of the NSOs. No, that's Masker. I'm getting confused by Masker's attire. It is white. I shouldn't be confusing it with the pink shirts out there.
Well, on the penalty line, it is fairly even. We've got 18 majors right now for Low Country. And as I said, Detroit Funk and Ringo Stardust with a little trouble each with four there. The Hellions of Troy do have 19 penalties. And Katie Bang on that last one actually picked up her fifth major. So she's the only one really in trouble. Baby Nuclear's picked up three. Epic Catastrophe's picked up three as well. But other than that, other than just a good number of minutes in the penalty box for both teams this half.
Yeah, I think we've been calling it right then, Lou. It's just that the penalties aren't what's making this score work. It is what's going on with the packs and these power gems.
Yeah, Low Country has done a nice job with the power jams. They've been getting the points on, but more importantly, when the power jams are against them, that defense, Detroit Funk stepping up, Lex McCusker stepping up, and they've just been, they haven't stopped the Hellions of Troy from putting points on the board during the power jams, but they have limited the numbers. So you can stop the bleeding, that's great, but if you could cut it down, that's even better.
When the Hellions get 5 and Low Country's getting 15 in their power jams, this is making a 2-1 score ratio here for us.
I'll take that trade all day long.
I would too. And I think we also have had that it actually is the Hellions jammers who are getting penalized a little bit more. Low Country's really pushing their blockers to the limit, so we have more blocker penalties to the Hellions of Troy. I think we have had more power jams in favor of Low Country.
Well, with the power jams really taking on so much more meaning nowadays, as we have seen, and people really taking huge advantage, it's one of those things for a team really to make sure that you don't go to the penalty box. It's one of the things I haven't really understood about the passive offensive as much. I don't understand why you wouldn't want to try to help your jammer through and maybe make sure that she doesn't pick up a major. I do realize that a lot of skaters have the ability to get through that four-pack on their own, but it's almost tempting, you know, fates to sit there and go, well, just penalize my jammer and...
Well, those passive offensive tire out your jammer. If you have a really deep jammer rotation, you could maybe afford that for the couple second savings, but we're not really seeing, we're seeing a much deeper jammer rotation out of Low Country than we are seeing out of the Hellions. And then we are also at the same time seeing Low Country being the team that's helping out their jammer.
Yes.
That has that little bit of rush, and these kinds of things are turning over in this, you know, Low Country's favor every time.
Yeah, and again, on the passive offense, there's one of those, if you have jammers at the caliber of like a Bonnie Thunders or, you know, those few that, you know what, you could just put the jammer against the team and leave the blockers at home, and there are those rare few jammers that can do that, and that's, you know, that to me is like one of the few reasons that you might want to, we're going to make you stop her first, and then we'll start helping her. But for a lot of the other part, it really just, it blows my mind sometimes that it's like, wow, wouldn't you like some help coming up there and sweeping in? And when Detroit Funk and Lex have been coming in and crushing the pack to the inside or the outside, and Sniper finds that hole.
And they don't need much. They only need half the pack. The jammer can usually manage another one or two on her own, but just taking a little of that pressure off. And we are in another power jam here with Sniper jamming for Low Country, the only star on the track. Baby Nuclear still in the penalty box, and a quick lead jammer for Sniper. And everyone just stopped, and a little bit of help on the outside. Totally read that coming. Rejected quite a ways away. The first 5-point power jam. I'm sorry, I have to giggle because it was just, it was so clear that it was coming from up here, and the Hellions were prepared for that.
Yep, and that's kind of like the pick that I'm talking about. We're setting the point, we're opening the lane, and that's how it's done.
It's not like it's the first time that the Low Country's done it to them either. You might want to start to be aware to the side where that hammer is coming from. And look at this, Detroit Funk taking the gem line for her own team. A little surprised with the number of penalties she has on her, but I think it's just going to be a little fun chance to see here. 1 minute and a couple seconds left in the first period.
I am excited. I have announced for Low Country for years, and you do not see Detroit jam much. But she is fun, and she is a powerful skater when she's out there. So with that kind of left-right motion, yeah, I think she can pick up that lead, Jay.
Oh, yeah, and there she goes. Detroit with the lead. Betty breaking through the pack for the Hellions. She was getting beat up pretty hard there for a while. Hellions losing another blocker. We're down to a 4-2 pack advantage for Low Country. Detroit pick up anything there? Nothing. Oh, how disappointing.
Yeah, that was a nice little bit of blocking there. Lehman Smothers had a little bit of help as well, but with just the two blockers, Detroit definitely saw that it was going to be held up just long enough for the Hellions of Troy jammer to get back up to the pack, so she calls it off. We've got just about 20 seconds left. We are going to get one more jam in.
And we're really going to get one more. Oh, those whistles are on the other track. I'm sorry, folks at home. I'm sorry, Lou.
I thought it was the whistles out there, too. I thought they were calling a timeout.
And this is Curls against Baby Nuclear. Baby Nuclear pushing apart that front wall. Something the Hellions need to change this just a little bit before we go into halftime. Lead jammer, Baby Nuclear. And number 21, Lil Weezy, giving it all she's got to slow up Curls so Baby can score. Baby stuck so hard behind Dutas Mania.
And a nice little ending take out there. I do believe that was Sweet Debacle.
2 points for the Hellions.
He took out Powerpuff Girls as she was coming back up to the track. Hey, you can hit until that fourth whistle. There's nothing wrong with that.
My name is Brenda Gold, and I've been at Rydell for 36 years almost. Everything is done by hand, basically. Just one pair actually going through at a time then. And some of them are multiple colors where it'll have 5-6 colors, metallics, the different colored full grains, you name it. Some of them are pretty wild. To me, the skaters are really important because that's what keeps us going here. It's the consumer or the skater that decides, okay, is it good enough for me or not? We want them to be happy, that's for sure.
You see, we have a 105 Lex on the jam line for Low Country. Takes a quick hit on a Betty off the jam line. And Betty pushing through at the front, and the Hellion's going to get lead jammer to start this first jam. But it's not like Lex McCusker isn't right hot on her tail.
Yeah, Betty did a nice job getting around Detroit Funk, but Lex just comes back, that jammer speed, taking the advantage away from the lead jam.
I have to say, I probably would have stayed in that myself a little longer. There were only... Oh, I apologize. No, it's the Hellions who are super short packed out there. So it was pretty amazing for her to get lead to begin with, that she was going to struggle a lot with against four. 2-on-4, that pack advantage way in the favor of the High Rollers.
And we're going to have Layman Smothers coming out as the jammer for the Hellions of Troy this time against Green Eyed Sniper.
I think they must be needing to go a little deeper there with Lehman, especially with the penalty potential trouble they have with Kate. But it is Sniper for lead.
Low Country did a nice job opening up that inside line for Sniper, and she knows that's going to happen, and she just ate that all day. Look at that, one blocker trying to hold back Sniper.
And she gets all of them, all four.
Beautiful, beautiful pass, calls it off.
And the High Rollers are picking up a little speed there at the end that the Hellions were not really able to keep up with. We have a Baby Nuclear on the jam line for the Hellions. 2-1 Powerpuff Curls for the High Rollers.
Present score 126-50. We have 28 minutes and 20 seconds left to go in our second half of action here at 2013 ECDX.
Pushing against a very solid back wall, getting a little bit of defensive help from their jammer. Low Country's jammer, even though they already have, making it 5-on. On the jammer there, and Hellion's jammer, Baby Nuclear, pushing it through the front. A little surprising for me. I did fantastic work from Baby Nuclear, and at the last minute, they're getting past Aphrodite Superstar.
Well, Powerpuff Girls finally found her way clear of the pack, so we got both jammers off on their scoring run. About a half a lap, a little less than a half a lap separating the two jammers.
Well, kudos to the Hellions blockers there for holding her up as much as they did. And Baby Nuclear through, jumping up and down on her skates to call off that jam for 4-0 Hellions. Well, that kind of changes things around, Lou.
Yeah, a little momentum going on. You can see Baby Nuclear fist pumping after that. She's ready to go.
Well, now Betty is going to be looking at a Detroit Funk on the jam line. Detroit, such a powerful blocker, and she pulls that into her jamming.
Again, I'm usually kind of shocked when Detroit's there. I never see her twice in a game.
And she just powers her way through that Hellions wall as Tina is giving Betty quite a bit of trouble at the back with a lot of help from her teammates. Uh-oh.
Yeah, Detroit Funk lost her foot and took out one of the Hellions of Troy, so she got called for a low block.
That puts her at 5 penalties, does it not?
Yes, it does.
So we have Betty as lead jammer. A lot of scrambling going on in this pack, and we are now to pack advantage Hellions 4-on-2.
And a nice job by the Hellions stretching out and bridging that back.
Hellions 4-on-1.
Attack of Joya, the lone Low Country High Roller out there.
And not able to do much as Betty comes around for a grand slam.
Well, this could be the momentum changer that the Hellions of Troy need right now.
Trying to block that jammer, or block that other blocker, and she ends up blocking her jammer a little bit, but grand slam number 2.
But she's helping. She's helping.
She did help. I imagine that these jammers are saying, I need you to do something.
And they did. They got her through that one. A nice job. It was Grace Smelly doing some good blocking work to the inside. So some good individual blocking as well as the team blocking for the Low Country High Rollers.
But
the Hellions of Troy did get some points out of that one, and they did have a little momentum going. They put up 24 quick points in just the last couple of minutes.
Short temper going to the box on a direction of gameplay brings the Hellions down to 3-2. We have a 2-on-2 pack out there. Baby Nuclear, the only jammer, with Detroit Funk standing in the box. Oh, fantastic offensive block by Katie Bang.
Yeah, she definitely opened up that line. Grace Smelly got pop to the outside, and just a beautiful job opening up that line.
Baby Nuclear passed all of the Low Country blockers and picks up her 4 points and calls it.
Well, Low Country did get their jammer back onto the track, so the power jam is over.
That was a big change all of a sudden here, Lou. We've seen from the first period, 126-78 for the Hellions of Troy.
Yeah, they brought down that it was about a 75-point difference there. Quickly brought down to 50. If they can keep that momentum going, and it's going to be tough to do against this blocking, but they definitely have a possibility of reeling this game back in.
Yeah, and I really like that they are changing the ratio at the moment. I'd like to see that momentum going and not being at that solid 2-1 ratio we saw most of the first period. That's definitely changing. But at the moment, we have Sniper as lead jammer for the High Rollers. She's approaching the possibility of lapping Betty. Betty, who goes down in the front from Sketo.
Yes.
And that is a grand slam.
Sketo can thump. That's one of the things you'd love about Spaghetti Fab. Fabulous, man. She's got some thumping booty shots. And she's an incredibly sweet person, too. But the booty shots are awesome.
They are. Bloody Knuckles Betty finally breaking through. Gonna slow down the bleed, although we already have 10 points on the board by Sniper. Sniper is going to keep pushing it, and she's motioning for her blockers to move it up. And she's helping to push them if she's not just steadying herself on them. She calls it. Picking up another two. I believe that'd be a 12-point jam then. Low Country High Rollers are having none of this, the Hellions coming back thing.
Yeah, the Sniper is one of those consistent jammers that, yes, if they really wanted to be mean, they could probably play her about 4 or 5 jams in a row and just break your spirit.
Lex McCusker taking the jam line for the High Rollers against Baby Nuclear for the Hellions. We have an empty penalty box, Lou.
That is amazing.
Wow.
Well, you know that's not good. By the end of this jam, that could be completely full.
Yeah, but at the moment, it was certainly worth noting. This has been, as you said earlier, the 40 penalties after just the first half. We've seen just so many penalties this bout from both teams, different ones, as Baby Nuclear takes lead for the Hellions of Troy.
Oh, and speaking of penalties, hey, Lex McCusker. So we have got a power jam again for the Hellions of Troy.
Power jams for the Hellions of Troy. And they are letting Baby Nuclear struggle this out on her own. We are getting a multiplayer block call. Outside pack is sent, a referee is sending Ateka Juwia to the penalty box for that. I guess she was most responsible.
Well, it took about, a nice inside pass there.
Detroit Funk didn't time that quite right. I'm more surprised she missed it.
I am too. Normally they are not that passive on the inside.
And the Hellions decide to give a little bit of help there. Louise comes in and just makes enough of the hole. That saved Baby Nuclear not only about 3 or 4 seconds, but I can't imagine how much energy she's really going to need for the rest of this bout.
Oh, definitely. And they are definitely going to be needing her. She has been one of those jammers that they are relying on.
Yeah, especially as we have here 603 Epic Catastrophe, who could be approaching some penalty trouble. Taking the jam line for them now on a power jam starting this jam.
And with that power jam, the lead now down to just 45 points. So the Hellions of Troy consistently getting in there.
Yeah, and we are now like to a 3-2 ratio. Much tighter. They'll be very good for the Hellions coming into their fresh rankings. And we have an out-of-play call. As Epic Catastrophe gets through and gets lead, her team cycling back, and she goes right around the London Bridge and picks up a grand slam. Lex McCusker back in the back, her initial pass. No scoring points for her now, and Epic Catastrophe holds the line. Gets right. No, she does not hold the line. That was a cut track. And she'll be going to penalty box Lex now on a power jam.
Well, let's see if Lex notices that she does have a power jam because she could definitely put up some time. She's had that resting point. She's got 5 points going on the board.
Lex doesn't have a choice, of course, finishing out the jam because Kate was the lead. We have no lead in this jam. We have 1:05. I'm sure Lex is, from what I'm seeing out there, Lex is trying to call it off. Of course, I'm sorry, you were right. She apparently was reading your mind, Lou.
Yeah.
She was like, why am I not lead?
Yeah, and I didn't even think that at first. You said that. Yep. Yeah, me and Lex, we're like simpatico.
So Lex has figured it out, and she's like, oh, I guess I need to just start scoring again.
No, she was just pointing out where her ribs were.
Ah, and they hurt from breathing so hard here as I fight through these walls. A little bump, really not a lot of trouble from the Hellions. Just she seems to spread them out as she comes through. The walls for the Hellions not staying together, just stringing out. Now, I like that offensive move. It was like the Low Country High Rollers tried to fake out the Hellions by pretending they were going to go in for an active offense.
I do like that move. The head
I'd
fake.
Be like, whoa. And it just, you know, I think it distracts you enough. They're going to come for me and turn your head. And the jammer's getting through. I have lost track. 25 points so far for Lex. And that's starting in the box. The jammer for the Hellions came in and is getting sent back. I don't know if she's getting sent back off. It looked like there was a motion that she was getting sent back to the box. And, yeah, she is headed back to the box. Can we take a look on the penalties? Because I thought Kate was in trouble. I think that's going to be 7. And that's going to be tough.
I'm not sure if that is her. I believe that you are right. That may very well be her 7th right there.
The cut track. I swear for her 6th she got a cut track, but maybe she was only on 4. We do have a Wicked Skatewear official timeout on the track right now. And it looks to me as though Coach Massacre is in there trying to argue for his jammer.
Well, we'll take this time to thank some more of our sponsors. We'd like to thank Double Threat Skates. Great place to get your skates. Also with Fifth Blocker Skates as well. And there's so many skate shops here. It's like, it's a skater's dream at ECDX. We are waiting to get the clarification on to what's going on there.
I'm not really clear if this is simply official timeout or an official review. Certainly have all the captains in the middle. We have Lehman Smothers, the captain for the Hellions of Troy. Detroit Funk, the captain for Low Country High Rollers, and she is in there with Agenda, who's also on their charter, but on the bench. The referees are stepping away to discuss what's been brought to them.
Well, apparently the Low Country High Rollers didn't like losing in the penalty minutes in the first half. They were only down by about 4. They have brought that back, and now they are leading in the penalty minute genre. They have picked up a total of 25 penalty minutes now, whereas the Hellions of Troy have 24. Most importantly, though, Epic Catastrophe, we're waiting on that clarification whether this is her 6th or her 7th major. She is the one in major trouble. Katie Bang also has 5 majors already. Detroit Funk picked up her 5th major as well.
102 for the Hellions of Troy. They have broke the century mark. I wasn't sure they were going to do that the way things are going early in that first period, but 163 to 102. Looking a little better for the Hellions. They've come out of their halftime very strong.
Well, so far they are winning the second half. You know, that 75-point deficit at the first half now down to just about 61 points.
And just lots of discussion. So we might be able to just talk about things up here.
Well, it's always wonderful here at ECDX, all the great vendors. Did you try any of the Philly egg rolls?
I have not tried a Philly egg. Is it inside or is it out?
It was like a steak egg roll with provolone cheese dip.
Oh, that sounds delicious.
It was yummy. Oh, the food vendors are great here. There and so many good choices. You have the healthy choices. You have this stuff that, hey, we've been announcing for a couple hours. We really need a beer and a cheeseburger.
Well, and again, I just have to do that. Props to Philly for thinking about all the things. They get feedback from everyone who attends every year. They solicit feedback from the skaters and the announcers and the coaches and the officials, and they work on improving ECDX every year. And what was a way to improve the Derby community here in the Northeast originally has continued to bring that that Goodwill worldwide.
Yeah, and there is a reason why this is voted as the premier event to go to. Divisionals are great. All the championships are great, but ECDX is just something special.
I know. I vote for it every year myself. So we have Powerpuff Curls pushing through, and it looks like she is lead jammer for the High Rollers. Epic Catastrophe still sitting in the penalty box, it looks like, for her sixth penalty minute.
And we're going to see Layman Smothers going to the penalty box as well. So the penalty box eating up a couple of the players for the Hellions of Troy, and it's going to pick up a third one here.
Lil Weezy working on a drawback, but gets sent to the box for something. I missed the call. Up grand slam for Curls. The first of what's looking like might be a few. She's getting the go-ahead from her jam coach. Yeah, go ahead and keep scoring.
And with those two blockers out there, that's going to be a split pack call, and Curls is going to be the lead through. So they are getting her through very quickly. Only a few seconds to get her through on that pass. And
Kate was standing, and the jam coach says, yep, call it off. We want to start this with just one jammer out there. We want to start the next jam on a power jam.
Well, it's excellent to know for the Hellions of Troy that Kate is not, that is not her seventh. She has been a great player, been helping out quite a bit, and they definitely need all their stars out there right now if they're going to try to come back in the second half.
They do. And here we have Sniper on a power jam start, 4-2 pack advantage for her. And she's taking it outside. She got a little help. It looked to me like from Ringo Stardust really opened up the outside for her. Kate trying to push through. She cannot afford to be stepping her skates out of bound here in this pass, especially with that star on, because she'll be sitting the rest of the jam without a jammer no matter what time she goes in.
And Sniper got an easy pass on that last one. They just opened up that line for her. The open sesame does work in roller derby, apparently.
I have to say, if I were the Low Country High Rollers right now, I wouldn't be calling off the jam. I'd try to see if I could get Kate back to the penalty box. But, you know, it's a little bit mean. They do call off the jam. Here we go. 181 for Low Country, 102 for the Hellions, 16:50 on the clock.
I like your strategy.
I'm sorry. It works.
It does. It's very, very smart.
They don't really need it, though. Low Country is doing just fine on their own without, you know, playing that. Let's tire that one of two primary jammers out so we don't have to see her.
But it's great game theory, and we are seeing more theory and more theory into these games.
Tiantina against Baby Nuclear. Tiantina getting the last little bit of hurting from Sweet Debacle. But she gets through in his lead, half a lap ahead of Baby. Baby doesn't look tired. For how much I've seen her out there, Baby's doing a fantastic job, jam after jam.
Yeah, she has. She's always had that energy, always that strength. And when she gets that lead jam, you see that fist bump. She is ready to go.
And there again, Detroit pulling a Hellion behind and going against slowing up the pack, making those 4 points real easy for Tiantina, and nothing for Baby Nuclear.
And Baby Nuclear, I believe, is going to the penalty box for an illegal procedure right at the end.
I always wonder what illegal procedures are. Sometimes I feel it'd be nice to get more calls built into illegal procedures so we know what they are.
Yes, I agree. It can be a little confusing sometimes.
And this is Powerpuff Curls on a power jam for the Low Country High Rollers. And a takeout by Katie Bang.
With just about 15 minutes left to go in this game, Powerpuff Curls could put one of those first nails in the coffin here.
Oh, yeah, the nail of the coffin that is almost nailed shut at this point now. She is lead jammer.
We were just using a little super glue before.
Well, who knows? The Hellions might have an axe in their back pocket.
Hey, well, it's time to break it out. Powerpuff Girls breaking her way through. She's going to pick up another five for the Low Country High Rollers. Spaghetto Fabulous going to the penalty box. She's the jammer for the Hellions of Troy sitting there all alone. And, you know, you don't want to be lonely
in derby.
Yeah,
keep her company. How sweet. None of the Low Country High Rollers. I've skated in some challenge bouts with Ringo Stardust and a couple of these ladies, and they are really sweet in the power in the challenge bouts. It's just fun to skate with
Southern hospitality.
Yeah.
We're all nice in the South.
And we have a timeout, Hellions. I think they need to get back on track. I think you need to go back and find what they found at halftime, and perhaps we're getting a little coaching here from Massacre.
Yeah, exactly, because they did come out at halftime. They were firing. They were doing nicely, but the penalty minutes starting to catch them again and again. You know, you're sending your jammers to the box. It's going to be a long day.
Yeah, with just under 15 minutes left, we have Epic Catastrophe on 6, but it's not like Baby Nuclear is not on 4 herself. So that's a pretty scary when your two primary jammers aren't out of risk of being sent out of the game.
Yeah, you are not a pretty thing to be worrying about that, especially when you use them as much as they do. Now, one of the things I was really impressed with Glasgow the other day is in the first half, I think they had a total of 4 penalty minutes.
Wow, clean game.
Extremely clean. Well, they've impressed everybody with their play here. The European teams really stepping up and not wanting to lay down to the States here. And they've done a beautiful job. But, you know, it's penalty control. It's a big part of the game.
Yeah, we saw that with the New York Shock Exchange, too, only having 2 penalty minutes in the first half to 18 or something in the teams for the Mass Maelstrom. So those kinds of things really can make a difference. And here, again, it's who is making the penalties in this bout, as we have a sniper for lead and 5 points for the High Rollers. Baby Nuclear out of the box, completing her initial pass. Detroit giving her some trouble, but lets her go.
Well, they shut down that inside line on Sniper. Nice job there. Detroit Funk opening up a little bit of a hole.
Sniper trying to call it off, but of course the Hellions not going to wait for those whistles. Going to take a hit on her anyway, so we can hit her out of bounds. All those little things make a difference. Lex McCusker on the jam line for the High Rollers. And Lehman Smothers, Hellions captain, out there jamming. I think they're starting to test a little deeper in their jammer pool now again.
Yeah, they're having to dig a little bit right now because Low Country has been adding on to that score again. Now it is 201 to 103, 98 points separating these two teams.
Yeah, back to those ratios you're seeing in the first period. Oh, and a direction appropriately called on one of the Low Country High Rollers blockers.
And Lehman Smothers finds her way out. She's going to pick up the lead jam.
I'm sorry, that was on a Hellion. Looks like 109, Bloody Knuckles Betty, who's been one of the Hellions' regular jammers, going to the box as a blocker.
Well, they had a power jam there for just a second as Lex McCusker went to the box for an illegal forearm. But unfortunately, Lehman Smothers picked up. Was that a cut track? I did not see.
It sure looks like a cut track.
That would be a cut track, yes, the little X.
We are so fortunate to have Ringster up here. We are able to see the skaters' penalties and what they are, at least were picked up by Ringster as in the jams they were in. So it helps us understand a little more of what's going on the track. So we can bring that to you at home. And here we have Lex completing her initial pass. And Lehman Smothers coming in behind her. Both of them, I believe, are going to be working on scoring at this point in time. Lehman making a quick decision about who she actually needed to come back in behind. That looks like a good grand slam for Lex.
Lehman took a lot of hits getting through the pack on that one, so that's going to take a little bit of endurance out of you.
Yeah, the High Rollers have definitely been putting the bigger, more powerful hits on the Hellions. Of course, now Lex wondering why she can't call it off. She's been to the box and back.
Lex has got to be, and Lex did get called for it. You can't call it off when you're not the lead jammer.
No, she got called off for skating out of bounds. I think you only get a penalty on that if you actually succeed in calling it off now. You know, back with the old rules, you'd get a minor for attempting, but we don't have to see that so much. This is a great opportunity for the Hellions. And they're going to put out their go-to jammer, Baby Nuclear.
And how she still has so much energy, it absolutely amazes me.
This skating out of bounds penalty to me definitely has got a little tougher recently. If you even do a stride out of bounds, even if you've been knocked out, now when they see that push,
Yeah, and again, that was a big mental mistake there. You're coming out of the penalty box, you should know you can't call off the jam.
You could see her wagging her head over that a little bit. And Baby Nuclear threw in lead. And just comes right into the middle of the chests of these skaters. And we are looking at a couple of direction calls. 8:59. Dutas Mania going to the penalty box for that one with the pivot cover.
And you can see Aphrodite just sitting there pointing, tapping her chest. Come to me. Come block me.
Oh, and the Hellions, they definitely learned a lesson from the Lowcountry High Rollers and went and helped their jammer out a little bit. But that is sending Katie Bang to the penalty box. Where are we sitting with her penalties? That is going to be her seventh.
Yep, that will be the final one.
Oh, wait, that might be her sixth. I don't know how quickly that is updated. The C is her direction. I'm not seeing a seventh. I apologize. We don't want to get people at home thinking that she's been sent out on her seventh trip. And we have Baby Nuclear still lead jammer, ducking around the outside, picking up 4 points and keeping the Lowcountry High Rollers scoreless. Look at this. 206 for Lowcountry, 138 for the Hellions.
Well, they missed. I heard something. Nice little push there.
Shift in fortunes. We're under 10 minutes remaining here in the second period. And they're putting Bloody Knuckles Betty back on the jam line for the Hellions. And Sniper for Lowcountry.
As you said, the Hellions of Troy putting up 35 points to the Lowcountry's 3 points over the last few jams.
Whoa! Lots of crazy jab blocking and people hitting the ground. And Betty still manages to get lead after picking herself back up. Yeah. But not with a lot out of pressure here.
Green-eyed Sniper right behind her and putting some speed on there. Little jammer-on-jammer action as they're coming around.
I saw a short temper trying to get those two from Lowcountry to slow up. Of course, Lowcountry not wanting to be a point and trying to pick up the speed of the pack, and they push right past that 0-0 jam.
Nice little battle jam there. That is going to bring us to just at 8 minutes, 20 seconds left to go in this second half here at ECDX. The Lowcountry High Rollers leading the Hellions of Troy, 206 to 138.
The clock has stopped. We have a timeout for the High Rollers. Clock has stopped at 8 minutes and 20 seconds.
And quick little update on the fouls there. Katie Bang does have 6 majors. Epic Catastrophe with 6 majors. With 4 majors is Baby Nuclear, Little Wheezy, Bloody Knuckles Betty. And that is the big penalty trouble right there for the Hellions of Troy. Lowcountry in a little bit of trouble as well. Lex McCusker picked up her fifth major. Detroit Funk has her fifth major. And Ringo Stardust has 4. And most of the others in pretty good shape.
Looks like we're getting back underway, and we are putting Detroit Funk back on the jammer line 3 times now, Lou. For the High Rollers and Baby Nuclear for the Hellions of Troy.
Well, I'm enjoying seeing this. I love the way Funk physically plays, and I'm actually kind of surprised they didn't do this when they were still doing scrum starts, because she can definitely give out a big hit.
Little Wheezy on a knockout on Detroit Funk. I'm really impressed with Little Wheezy's play here for the Hellions. She's smart. She gets him out. She's short, but she really does the job. And there again, she does a drawback on Detroit that is giving her jammer grand slams and points.
And Lex going to the penalty box once again. So Hellions of Troy got a little momentum going on right now.
Yeah, and I mean, if I had to pick an MVP for the Hellions, it'd probably be Baby Wheezy and all this jamming. But out of that pack, certainly a lot of effect from Lil Wheezy. A lot of very positive effect. And another grand slam, natural grand slams for Baby Nuclear as Detroit has been stuck in the pack all this time. Simply amazing.
Well, Detroit did get out of the pack finally, and we do have both jammers on their scoring run. Maybe nuclear is going to be driven to the outside and finally call that off. But another, like you said, a big jam there for the Hellions of Troy, and they are marching back.
A 3-2 pass in the last pass there. Detroit just really turned on the gas at the end and managed to pick up a couple hips. Less than 7 minutes remaining in this half. We have 109 Betty back on the jam line for the Hellions, 2-1 Powerpuff Girls for the High Rollers.
And on that last jam, Lex McCusker picked up her sixth major.
Utah's Mania getting a nice hit, stopping Betty's pass on the inside. But Betty gets around the outside on corner two and finds herself lead.
Powerpuff Girls does a nice job avoiding a couple of hits, but still gets stuck towards the front of the pack. Finally gets that little bit of separation. So we have both jammers off on their scoring runs again.
Nice cycling from the front wall of the Hellions of Troy as they hold things up and give their jammer a chance to score. And she is going to get... Oh, I apologize. She did not get a cut track. And she is calling it off.
Yeah, I believe Spaghetto Fabulous goes down on that one, so just luckily avoiding that cutting the track.
It looked like the jammer was starting to call a penalty on someone. I thought he was calling it on his own jammer. He was calling it on one of the pack skaters. A lucky situation for the Hellions of Troy as they move up to 154-5, still behind the High Rollers to 11.
Still, that's a great comeback, though, down to 55 points. It was just 98 points 2 minutes ago, 3 minutes ago. So a lot of positiveness going on. Green-Eyed Snipers, she's going to try to find that line for the Lowcountry High Rollers.
But Baby Nuclear, the most forward jammer at the time, and she does break through and gets lead again. She's making some kind of signals to her on her helmet to her pack. Number 40, Skinner Box, taking a hit. Again, Sniper, but Sniper pulling through. Baby Nuclear already in her scoring pass, and here she passes Sniper. Natural grand slam and calls it, I think not even realizing that Sniper had never left the pack.
Wow, I am absolutely amazed right now. The Hellions of Troy defense just showing up all of a sudden here, and they've been doing a great job slowing down Sniper. They've been doing a great job slowing down Detroit Functions. She's been out there. They're getting their jammer through the pack very quickly, and
holding up the High Rollers. This is a very different game than we've seen all night.
This last 4.5 minutes, if it's going the way it has been, is going to be a very, very tough 4.5 minutes for the Lowcountry High Rollers.
Bloody Knuckles Betty jamming for the Hellions. She takes a couple hits from Tina, but stays inbounds and just keeps hopping. She's pushing against the very last blocker. I think that's Detroit. And again, the Hellions of Troy, master lead jammer. And their blockers are just tenacious in the pack.
Now, had they shown up like this, this would have been a completely different game early on.
And there we go. Betty through and calls it off. A 4-0 jam for the Hellions of Troy, bringing up to 164.
So we've got about 47 points separating these two.
Just amazing.
Doing math.
A 4-3 ratio here we have. So the Hellions clearly winning the second period.
Oh, clearly.
They've stayed out of the box. They've kept their jammers and their blockers out of the box. We have a couple in trouble, but it's mostly a carryover from that first period that's hurting them.
Definitely. Now, like you said, they do have a couple that you got to watch out for, two of them with six right now.
Powerpuff Girls jamming for the High Roller, but it's Baby Nuclear, lead jammer for the Hellions of Troy.
And she just looks like she's getting more energy.
Yeah, she's feeding off the crowd. The Hellions have a very rambunctious, very involved crew here cheering them on. And Baby Nuclear hitting Quidditch 4-0 for the Hellions, bringing them up to 168. Oh, boy.
Yeah, they're going to need to take a chance, though, or two here. They're going to have to trust on your blockers because you need more than just the one scoring pass if they're going to get it in his last 2.5 minutes.
They're going to need a power jam if they're going to win in the last 2.5 minutes. I think no matter what happens in these next 2.5 minutes, the Hellions of Troy are going to go home happy with their performance in this game.
Well, during this second half, they have just done a beautiful job, even when at the point where they kind of stumbled for just a few minutes.
We have Bloody Knuckles Betty jamming for the Hellions, but it is Sniper pulling through the front of the pack for lead. Bloody Knuckles Betty tripping over at Detroit Funk. Detroit getting hit by Hellions Pivot, 10-34 Sweet Debacle. Just a lot of scrapping in this pack.
And you could hear a big sigh of relief from Low Country when they got that lead jam.
Yeah, they had a change of what was going on there with the Hellions, because they'd been winning so much, so hard this whole game. And to see that lead whittled away, 4 points for the Low Country. Tina up on the line against Baby Nuclear. I am just amazed at Baby Nuclear's energy and power and ability here.
She has got some stamina. Definitely one of the rock stars of this game. Absolutely impressed. And the fact that she's just got so much energy left.
Baby Nuclear, Baby steps around the outside at first. And wow, inside, outside, inside, outside. And Baby Nuclear, lead jammer. Huge smile. You can see that. I almost had to put my sunglasses back on up here. Tina stuck in the back.
Well, this could be that push right now.
And Tina getting sent to the box for an out of play. An out of play. She must have been engaging a blocker out of bounds.
Yeah, well, that's going to be the last on the time clock. So we are not going to see another jammer on the floor for the Low Country High Rollers.
The very first time I ever saw a jammer out of play was here at ECDX, and it just flabbergasted me that it was possible. And that's one of the great things here about the East Coast Derby Extravaganza, is you just get to see so much derby that you see these little nuances of the rules.
Oh, definitely. You get to see, and you get to see the people that are exploring the rules, trying different things. And this is one of the great places to do it. We can try things.
The Low Country High Rollers not wanting to give up a single point. Baby Nuclear calling out. Masker coming in and asking for a timeout to stop the clock. And the Hellions got this power jam that they needed to have a chance at winning. 215 to 181.
So we've got 34 points separating these two teams, and that is well below the record. The record, of course, being 4.
It takes some incredible pack work, though. I always feel that when they put up those 45-point records for the jammers, they should list the blockers that made it happen, too.
Yeah, I agree. And there can be some situations. I actually was one of the announcers on the third 45-point record-tying jam. But it was kind of bad because one of the teams kind of forgot to put most of their team on the floor, and they actually only had two blockers on the floor. And
I saw, I believe, what was probably the first 45-point jam, but it was in MRDA play. It was Jurassic Park, and the reason he got to do it was because the opposing team failed to put a jammer on the track. And so, you know, 2 minutes without a jammer is a huge deal.
Yeah.
It makes those things much more possible. So, yeah, technicality from the other team really helped. But it's not like the pack didn't do the work. And here the Hellions have decided to go for this very passive offense of jumping way back, forcing things back there, pulling up as we see number 10, Tina, standing in the penalty box. Of course, the Hellions do control this jam. They do control the lead. Tina on her initial pass. 109, Betty working her way through the front. She has 5 points, a grand slam. Tina has not completed her initial pass. So this is leaving Bloody Knuckles Betty to continue to fight for her points.
Betty's trying to find her way around Detroit Funk. Just finds the inside seam and steps around another 5 points.
This time a natural grand slam as her pack keeps Tina in the back for her.
Tina doing a nice little bit of bobbing and weaving. She's got one left to beat, and that's going to be Lehman Smothers.
Working it until Tina finally does break through. And we are continuing with the scoring for the Hellions. She does have the option to end it and only keep her points. It won't be a win, but it apparently is going to be enough. She's going to take her three. and end this game. The Hellions of Troy have every reason to be proud of this 215-194 score, but the Lowcountry High Rollers, the winners here.
Oh, yes. Lowcountry doing a great job for the most part, but the Hellions of Troy just waking up at the last quarter of the game, and wow, had their defenses been a little bit stronger, it definitely would have been a completely different game.
Yeah, if we had seen the last 15 minutes all game, the Hellions might have been coming in above the 79th place in the WFTDA standing that are